You're listening to DNTO here on CBC Radio 1, and coming up, something a little bit different. There's a birthday party going on in Havana, Cuba today for a 102-year-old Canadian woman. Her name is Mary McCarthy, and she's lived longer in Cuba than she has in her birthplace, Newfoundland. During her time in Cuba, Mary's life has been shaped by two men, both Cuban. One was her husband, Pedro Gomez Cueto, the other, Fidel Castro. Gomez Cueto married Mary McCarthy, and together they settled in Cuba 80 years ago. And Fidel Castro, well, you might argue he's been almost as much of an influence on Mary's life as her husband. Marie Wadden of CBC St. John's talked to Mary McCarthy about her extraordinary life. It's a history of Mary's personal transformation and one woman's view of the Cuban experience. Here's Eyewitness to the Revolution.
Mary McCarthy is sitting by the window where she spends most of the day. The window looks out onto one of St. John's oldest streets. Mary can see who's coming and going from the small neighborhood store. Sometimes she drifts off to sleep in her chair. I can see Mary in the window as I park by the front door. Her eyes are closed. I wonder what other people passing by this wooden row house think when they see Mary looking out. They probably think she's just an old lady who's lived in this house all her life. A house surely as old as she is. Mary McCarthy was born in St. John's on April 27, 1900. Her father was a Water Street merchant. There were just two children. Her sister died young. Mary was taught by Roman Catholic nuns who nurtured her musical talent. When she was 20, she went to university in Boston. There, she met the first man who would change her life forever. She met him at the opera.
The first night that I was at the opera, a very charming young gentleman came and sat next to me. And after a while, we began to get into conversation. He said how much he was Spanish and how much he loved music and so forth. And we passed a very pleasant evening. So for each concert for the season, which was short, we met. So at the end of the time, of that time, he said to me, could I have permission to call on you? I know you're a student of music. And well, I said, as you know, the nuns, I'm in the St. Joseph nuns. He said, all right, you'll find out if I can get permission to call on you. And then I got permission from the Mother Superior to go out to luncheon or to a movie. It will always be very early in the evening there, you know. So at the end of the second year, he said to me, Mary, I would like to marry you. And he said, I would have to meet your family. I said, yes. Well, I said, at the end of the term, you come back to Newfoundland with me and meet my father and mother. So he came down. He was here a few days. So he got my father's permission on the condition that I would stay at home 1 year. My father said, let her stay 1 year because I want her to make her mind up well. She will be leaving us, so we want to be sure. So at that year, I stayed and I taught at Little Dame.
After a year apart, Mary still wanted to marry Pedro Gomez Cueto. Her parents relented, and they got married in 1923.
So my father and mother came up with me, with us, and we were married in Boston. And then after a few days, they returned to St. John's, and we took a big ship for Europe. And we were traveling for about 8 months in Europe.
Mary's parents had reason to worry. Gomez Cueto was 15 years older than Mary and planned to take her to live in a foreign country. But in other respects, she'd made a good catch. Her new husband was a wealthy businessman who exported leather from the United States to South America. He also manufactured leather goods. But more importantly for Mary, he was kind and, she says, romantic.
Of course, he was very poetical, you know. He was always reciting poetry and humming musical arias, you know.
This was the start of the fairy tale that was Mary's life for the next 28 years. Now she was Mary McCarthy Gomez Cueto, the wife of a wealthy Spanish businessman. He doted on her. In Havana, where they settled, her husband built a huge villa in the country club park area where all the wealthy people lived. A bronze plaque is woven into the wrought iron entranceway to their villa. It says Villa Mary, not Villa Maria, Villa Mary. The Cuban army was one of Senor Gomez's biggest clients, a good customer to have. He manufactured the soldiers' boots. By the time Mary arrived in Havana, the Cuban army was well established as the most dominant force in Cuban life. The army propped up the corrupt rulers who permitted the United States to colonize the island. By the 1950s, U.S. companies owned 75% of Cuba's main export, sugar, and 60% of Cuba's land. But Mary was blissfully unaware of Cuban politics. The new bride was preoccupied instead with learning what she needed to know to be the successful wife of a millionaire businessman. The couple entertained a lot at their villa. They never had children. Mary threw her energies into becoming a superb hostess. She hosted musical evenings that became central to the cultural life of the wealthy in Havana. These were mainly foreign immigrants with businesses and land in the country. Despite a general strike by workers in 1933, the army held power and supported puppet governments for the next two decades. Mary was unaware, it seems, of the growing discontent outside her elite social circle. She founded a musical society. Members helped to bring the most important European artists of the time to Havana.
And we formed a very good orchestra and brought in some of the best leaders, the best orchestra leaders in the world. Tchaikovsky and Sir Thomas Beecham we've had down there, you see. And of course I entertained all of these and knew them, and it was a very interesting world, you know, in their world.
There was another cultural scene in Havana at the time. Havana had become a mecca for party-loving Americans, rich Americans. Some of them were Mary's neighbors.
The summer wind came blowing in from across the sea.
All of Hollywood used to come to Cuba, you know, all of the big stars. Just behind my house is a residence that Frank Sinatra had bought and lived, came every year.
All summer long, we sang a song, and then we strolled that golden sand.
Kept the house on, you see, and kept a couple of servants, and then used to come back every year and spend 3 or 4 months of the year there, you see. You have sun every day, and the beaches are unique. Gorgeous beaches.
Those days and nights, they went flying by.
Yes, Havana was called, at that time, the playground of the American millionaires, you see, and Hollywood.
Americans had shares in the largest hotels and casinos on the island. They even owned a big part of the Cuban phone and light companies. Large U.S. corporations grew very rich off Cuba's resources, but the people themselves remained very poor. Throughout the 40s and mid-50s, the partying went on. Frank Sinatra, Nat King Cole.
Mujer, si puedes tú con Dios hablar.
There were great favorites at Tropicana, you know, which at that time was probably the best cabaret in the world. In the world. espejo de mi corazón. It was so fantastic. The girls were all particularly picked, you know, beautiful. And then they used to take some of the animals from the zoo and put them up in the trees, you know, the monkeys and the animals that would be inoffensive, you know. But it gave us such a wonderful feeling, you know.
Para que quiero otros besos si tus labios no me quieren ya besar.
And there they had a big casino. Cuba had gambling. She had permission to gamble. Now, you know, nobody gambles in Cuba. A lot of money was gotten that way, American dollars, you see, into the casinos. And that helped its social life, you know, a great deal.
De Santiago de Cuba, el doctor Fidel Castro recorre a bordo de un tanque Sherman la ciudad de Camagüey, donde es aclamado delirantemente.
It couldn't last. A young Fidel Castro was waiting in the wings to put a stop to the party that the average Cuban had no hope of ever attending. Mary's fairy tale came to an end a few years before Fidel Castro came to power. In the late 1940s, Pedro Gomez Cueto was diagnosed with leukemia. He received treatment at a clinic in Boston.
They did everything they could for him. But the latter days, his doctor said to him, look, Gomez Cueto, I have a big pill here, a big pink pill that has just come on the market. And it's for leukemia. But now he said, it's not proven yet as a perfect cure. Would you like to take the risk to see if it would help you? He said, yes. He took the risk. We had a suite at the Ritz-Carlton. I said, wonderful. So I took him back, and he was all right that night. But the next night, he had a heart attack and died. The pill was too strong.
Mary brought her beloved husband's body back to Cuba and buried it in a mausoleum where she too will be buried one day. She vowed she would not leave the country or ever marry again.
When I look back now, I don't know how I could have done it, you know? Be all alone and just with servants in your house, that's all. But I mean, no real friend or relative, you see. My husband dead and my parents dead and nobody. Nobody at all. But I thought, well, after all, you're not going to die. You have to carry on. So I did. Carry on. And I put my time to more useful ways of living, you know.
Mary spent more time on her charities. She was a director at a home for foundlings, babies left on the doorstep of local hospitals. And she helped to establish a home for Havana street children.
I became quite friendly with one of the outstanding priests in Havana. He was a great worker, you know. And Father Teste. So he said to me one day, you know, Mary, I have an ambition. I would like to start Boys Town here. He said, would you help? I said, yes, that's a magnificent project. So he started, and I became the president. Of course, I got a group of my rich friends together, you know, and we started. And he collected $250,000. And that money he spent by building the buildings that are still standing in outside of Havana.
Mary lived comfortably for the next few years. She had her house, her servants, a Cadillac. She had $250,000 in a trust fund left by her husband. Of course, she had all his business assets.
PMQ, desde La Habana, Cuba.
There was time to grieve her husband's loss, but not enough time to prepare her for what happened next.
The General Staff orders all militiamen of the battalions of Havana to join their respective units immediately.
She remembers New Year's Day in 1959 as though it was just yesterday. It was General Fulgencio Batista's last day in power.
It was memorable because they were in the presidential palace where Batista was entertaining officially. About 12 o'clock, his aide-de-camp came to him and whispered in his ear, General, they always call him General, you see. General, Fidel Castro is in Havana. He said, what? In Havana. They had waiting for them always, 5 or 6 planes. He went over to his wife. He said, take your jewelry, we're leaving. He flew up to an island near Spain. He had bought already, had bought a house there in case of an emergency. They flew there and they stayed there and died there.
Departure touched off while rejoicing in the capital as the first elements of rebel forces entered Havana. From his stronghold in the wild Sierra Maestra Mountains, Cuba's Fidel Castro emerged triumphant after 2 years of guerrilla warfare against the Batista regime.
I wasn't a bit frightened, no. I don't think, on the contrary, he was very joyously received. He had a lot of people who were behind him. The severe laws didn't come into force until some months later, so you didn't realize, the rich people didn't realize what they were going to lose, you know.
When the new laws did come into effect, most of her husband's assets were seized by the state because the couple's wealth had come from a cozy relationship with the army that opposed Castro. Mary was given a small monthly income to live on.
Do you know how much? 200 Cuban pesos a month. You know, gotten right down to the bottom, you see.
She still gets her 200 pesos, about $12 a month Canadian.
I was all alone, so why go into that?
Tell me about it. What happened?
Oh, that's too sad. All the joy seemed to have gone out of Havana, you know. There were many, many suicides.
She didn't lose everything, however.
They don't take people's houses. That's not the revolution. They don't take your house. You will always have your own home. In fact, Fidel said that nobody would ever not have a roof over his head, and it's true. And before, they used to, you'd put you out on the street, you know? If you didn't pay your rent, you had to get out. But not now. He's a friend of the poor, you know.
And that's how Fidel Castro endeared himself to Mary McCarthy of St. John's. It wasn't an overnight conversion, mind you. She describes this period as the toughest time of her 102 years.
Well, of course, when I look back over, the most difficult was the acceptance of the new regime in Cuba. That was my most difficult. And the adjustment that I had to make to it, you see. And it came little by little, every day a little, you see, and understanding a little and reading about it and listening to the other people. Much lamentation, you know. And others delighted with the new regime because they have earned more, they have gotten more, they're poorer people and they've gotten more, so little by little you adjust yourself, you see.
She learned to live on very little. She taught music, and through her instruction, she inadvertently became a counter-revolutionary. She met Alberto Arango at a bus stop. He had a beautiful tenor voice and wanted to develop it. Mary taught him privately for 10 years. Then he got a job with the Cuban Opera Company.
About 5 years ago, the opera was given an engagement, the Cuban Opera, to go to Madrid and give so many performances. So, of course, he went along. And when they were to return, he stayed in Spain and has a magnificent job. Has his own apartment, has his own piano, and still sings.
Mary understands why people like Arango want to leave.
The salaries are very low in Cuban pesos, and they have a struggle to live, you know. If you don't have dollars in Cuba, it's very hard to live, you see. And it's too bad. Fidel doesn't want them to leave, you know, but he can't give them more salaries because they haven't got the money. The American embargo is what's keeping everything so bad, you see.
If you want to get Mary going, talk to her about the U.S. embargo of Cuba.
The United States don't want communism so near their territory, you see? That's what it is. China is communist, yes. Terribly communist. But she's a long way away, you see? And she has many billion of people. And Cuba's a small country. Cuba's no menace to the United States. And although she has a regime of socialism, well, I don't think that's going to annoy the United States in any way. Everybody in Cuba is not a socialist, and there are many people live there.
Mary has seen good things come out of the Cuban Revolution, principally universal health care and better education.
The percentage of the mortality of children in Cuba is very, very low. And that, with all of the scarcity that there is in Cuba, even medicines, it was down to 4% mortality.
Despite being one of Cuba's longest living residents, Mary McCarthy doesn't see a lot of the dictator. There is a visit, however, once a year.
On Canada Day, he goes to our embassy, and he's always so congenial, you know. And he'll always say to me, I know you, but I don't remember your name. And I say, no, Comandante, you couldn't remember my name out of the millions. You have to remember. Well, I think Fidel Castro has done a great deal for Cuba. And there are other things that I don't admire so much about his politics. I think there are some socialistic laws that are very humane, very humane. They have good schools, and every child is educated. Today, the university is free. And Fidel Castro turns out 10,000 doctors a year, the sick and the old. He's a good person. He's a good person. But his idealism is communism. But I think that he has done a lot of good things for Cuba. He's opened up the whole country. I think the United States made an awful mistake not to have received Fidel Castro in the beginning when he came up to Washington, and not to have talked with him and got his ideas. And I think the history of Cuba today would be different.
Mary, we'll be getting ready now very shortly for our trip. And do you have your suitcase just about ready?
It's time to go.
On Sunday, we'll
time for Mary to leave this house in St. John's and return to Cuba.
With your beautiful garden, you'll enjoy that, seeing that.
It's most likely her last visit to Newfoundland.
Have your suitcase just about all packed up.
She knows there's not a lot of time left, and whatever is left she wants to spend in the adopted country she's come to love so well.
What I would like to see for Cuba is the doing away of the embargo, number one. And immediately, everything would be normal, because it would relieve everything. And in that way, we'd get on our feet. I lost quite a bit, but I've looked at it this way, that if what I've lost has been properly used, which I think it has been, for the betterment of education and the better housing and more children on the streets begging or anything like that, I think that's been well utilized. And it was just part of my destiny. And God has given me good health to enjoy what I have now, the little I have now.
I'm Marie Wadden in St. John's.
Para Marcané, llego a Puerto, voy para Mayarí.
Thanks to Marie Wadden from CBC in St. John's for bringing Mary McCarthy's story to us.